उधर
ये मंत्र तो लेके हम पैदा ही हुए हैं सर. ठीक है शुभम. ऑल राइट. सो गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन डिकोडिंग जीआई एंड एचपीपी ऑन्कोलॉजी वेबिसोड सेशन एंड कंटिन्यूइंग आवर वेबिसोड ऑन इसोफेजियल एंड जी जंक्शन कैंसर्स. सो टुडेज टॉपिक फोकसेस बेसिकली ऑन नियोएडजुवेंट स्ट्रेटजीज their indications and optimization and actually a focus on adjuvant treatment in esophagus cancer also. So without wasting much time, I invite Dr. Ulas Batra, and he is co-director Department of Medical Oncology and Chief Thoracic Medical Oncology in Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Institute, and he basically will give a lecture and talk about new adjuvant strategies in esophagogastric cancer. So welcome you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shefali, and it's an honor to be here. It's after a long time that I'm speaking about something other than lung and breast
right.
and colon. So thank you for giving an opportunity to talk about esophagogastric cancers. And when I saw the topic, you know, new adjuvant strategies and management of gastroesophageal carcinoma, my first reactions over here basically was, you know, I mean, esophageal cancer, localized gastroesophageal cancer, was a surgeon's and a radiation oncologist domain. You know, I mean, it was almost like medical oncologist not allowed, you know? I mean, we have always heard, no, Indians not allowed. So it was like medical oncologist not allowed in a gastroesophageal carcinoma. And today when I am asked about to speak about new adjuvant strategies, it is nice. So Dr. Vinita, thank you for giving this field also to medical oncologists. And my subsequent reactions over there was fine. I mean, they have called me to give a talk. But why? Let's always start with why. And I always tell my residents, you know, please read this book about why you should always start with why in esophageal or any cancers. So let's look at the data actually. And the data basically says that, you know, esophagus cancer, esophagus cancer is a high incidence cancer. It is a 5,72,000 new cases per year, but the mortality is very, very high. 5,09,000 deaths per year. That is 1 in 20 cancer deaths for all cancer because of esophagus cancer. It's a bad cancer actually. If you look at the data again over here, you know, I mean, lung and esophagus, if you look over here, 5-year survival for all stages is only 12%. So the data regarding mortality and incidence is almost equal to what a lung cancer is. And that is probably why the medical oncologist and the radiation oncologist and the surgical oncologist need to come together and talk. Now let's talk about why do we need a combined modality treatment? Because if you have a T1A and T1B lesions, which is very rare in India, and this you have a good 5-year survival. But if you have anything which is more than T1 or N+, you have only a 25% survival more with resection only. And R0 resection is very, very important. There is 0% survival with an R1 resection. So again, very important is that combined modality treatment is very, very important for a locally advanced gastroesophageal cancer. Now the rationale for a combined modality new adjuvant strategy is the surgery is excellent for removing tumor masses and the chemo radiation therapy will be better in eradicating subclinical disease, and we can have a radiosensitization, and we can, we can control the metastatic disease also. So that rationale for neoadjuvant treatment is that 1+1 is basically more than 2, and that is what the rationale of neoadjuvant therapy is. So let's look at esophagus cancer. So again, you know, I did a lot of studies for this. So you have esophageal cancer, you have gastroesophageal cancer, and you have gastric cancer. Let's separate. In books, you will find out similar strategies, but similar strategies actually are not required. Let's talk about the esophageal cancer first. And that is what I'm going to talk initially about, the esophageal squamous cell cancer. I would like to start with the neoadjuvant chemo radiation in this. I will talk about the evidence, the tolerability of the regimens, the PCR rate, the PFS rate, the OS advantage. We will then say, can we extrapolate this data and put neoadjuvant CTRT into earlier stages? We will then talk about salvage surgery, and then we will talk about the future directions. So when you talk of the evidence, the first trial which comes to your mind is basically the CROSS trial. And the CROSS trial, for all the residents who are listening over here, it was a trial of the neoadjuvant chemotherapy basically, and in which people were randomized between esophagectomy alone or chemotherapy with paclitaxel and esophagectomy. And that is what was basically was the trial design. Now, in this, 75% had adenocarcinoma, 23% had squamous cell CA, and 2% had large cell undefined CA. So we always say, you know, gastroesophageal may cross kaam nahi karega, aisa nahi hai, it will work. Now look at the data over here. This is where, you know, this is where Dr. Vinita and Dr. Ullas or Shefali will go and beat Dr. Ashish Goyal coming over there. You can see the chemo radiation, that is a new adjuvant people, 95% people completed the new adjuvant treatment. 90% of the people underwent surgery. So no, you do not lose anything if you do not, if you give new adjuvant treatment, classical surgeons thing, as compared to only 86% people who actually underwent surgery. The grade 3, grade 4 hematological toxicities were reasonably okay with 8%, 11%. So the drug, the regimen basically is a very well tolerable regimen. Now let's look at the median overall survival. 48.6 months versus 24 months. Medical oncologists, radiation oncologists, where have you seen a doubling of the survival? Surgeons, I don't think any surgical thing, robotic, non-robotic, has actually led to such an increase in the overall survival. And this is OS that we're talking about. Median PFS, 37.7 versus 16.2. The distant progressive rate, progression rate had come down. The local progression rate had come down. And again, 92% of people underwent an R0 resection. Now, look at the graph on the left, my dear residents. And now look at the graph over here. The graph here on the right is KEYNOTE-189. Now, how can I not include a lung cancer topic when I am talking about? Very passionate about that. Pembro plus chemo is the standard when you're talking about a non-oncogenic lung cancer. Almost the same graphs which you see if you do a RTCT as a new adjuvant versus only surgery. So I think that was a wonderful result. Now look at, now let's look at the squamous cell carcinoma. So look at the dark black line up front. This is if you undergo a CRT plus surgery versus if you undergo a surgery alone. This much is the difference between if you give a new adjuvant chemotherapy or not, and that was actually fantastic. Again, the patterns of failure, the loco-regional failure rate was decreased, the peritoneal carcinomatosis rate was decreased, the distant failure rate was decreased, and this data basically showed that there was not even a single subset which did not benefit from a neoadjuvant chemo radiation. And cross-trial is basically called as the game changer in the neoadjuvant management of CA esophagus. Now, is that the only one? This everybody will know. So I did a more little bit more searching. There was another regimen which was there, which was nivolumab cisplatin along with CTRT, along with radiotherapy, then surgery. Again, look at the results. The median overall survival is 100.1 months. 100.1 months where you get only 24, 25 months. The surgical arm also did well with 66 months, but the HR was 0.71. There was increase in R0 resection rate. There was an increase in PCR rate. There was no increase in perioperative mortality. Now, this was the summary of the new adjuvant CTRT trials. And if you look at the cross trial, the second line from the bottom, the squamous cell carcinoma, you have a 82 versus 21 months overall survival advantage, which was seen with the cross-trial regimen. The drug is absolutely well-tolerable, and there is an absolute benefit of neoadjuvant chemo radiation therapy in CA esophagus. And that is the results which we are seeing over here. So we did great in the stage 2-3 onwards. Will we do better? So let's do neoadjuvant chemotherapy in an early stage also. You know, medical oncologists by nature are greedy. So we thought, okay, fine, you know, the answer for everything is neoadjuvant chemotherapy, but no. If you have a T1, T2 lesion, please do not go ahead and do a neoadjuvant chemotherapy because the results are absolutely the same. So anything with more than T1 or anything with N1, please go ahead and give a neoadjuvant chemo radiation. T1, N0, no need to give a neoadjuvant chemo radiation. Now, we again got, you know, the radiation oncologist got greedy. They said, let's give neoadjuvant chemotherapy and then give definitive RT versus surgery. And these were two trials, small trials, incomplete trials, but this is all that we have. Now, FFCD trial N9102 had an induction chemo radiation. They were then randomized between surgery and definitive CTRT. The German trial again did induction chemo followed by CTRT or surgery. In the left, you can see there was no difference. In the right, you can see the 34% people did not undergo surgery. Still, there was an advantage of the surgery. And surgery definitely reduced a local recurrence rate and subsequent palliative intervention. And the HR was 2.26 in that. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by definitive chemo radiation is definitely inferior strategy to what in a esophageal squamous cell carcinoma to probably a neoadjuvant chemo and surgery is. Now, as surgeons and medical oncologists always we say, you know, not everybody will respond. What about non-responders to CTRT? So not everybody will respond. What happens if you have a non-responders to CTRT? Now, again, these are retrospective collected data. Even if you your patient does not respond to CTRT, this was a trial and you do a salvage surgery. The results are by and large are similar, actually. This was again the FFCD 9102 trial. Only thing which basically came over there was that if you have given a radiotherapy dose more than 55, your mortality morbidity is higher. If you have a high volume center, your mortality is actually a bit lower. But if you give any CTRT, your patient is progressing, even in that case, and the disease is localized, probably surgery can still be a very, very good option. Now, what about neoadjuvant chemotherapy alone? We got greedy and we fell flat on the face. But there are a lot of institutes which actually give neoadjuvant chemotherapy alone in squamous cell carcinomas also. There are basically three trials which have looked at that, small numbers. The MRC E02, 30% people squamous cell carcinoma, JCOG trial, INT113 trial. But look at the surgical dropout arms in the last one, 40%. Look at the five-year-old survival, very, very less. Local recurrence rates are very, very high. Now in esophageal cancer, I told you very clearly that the purpose of giving neoadjuvant chemo radiation is increase in R0 resection. If you're not getting an increase in R0 resection, there is no point in doing. So in my mind, probably chemotherapy alone is a slightly, we'll discuss in the tumor board and in the panel discussion, but probably neoadjuvant chemotherapy, radiotherapy scores over NACT alone. So probably neoadjuvant chemotherapy, the medical oncologist can be called as also ran in the neoadjuvant strategy and not as the guy which came actually over there. Now, what does the future behold? We have a medical oncologist. We are very interested in the looking at the future, you know, what exactly is happening around over there. Now, this is a very interesting paper which I have seen, which said, let's compare ctDNA levels basically. If you have a ctDNA level which was negative, so you give RTCT, you measure the ctDNA level prior, you finish it off, and then you do. And if you have a level which is negative, these are the people which will do very, very well. Now, whether these people can be avoided surgery, we do not know. That was one. But the more important thing which was there is what came 1 week back or maybe 2 weeks back on April 4th. Now you have given neoadjuvant chemotherapy, radiotherapy, patients who have not achieved a PCR. So look at this, checkmate 577, adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, patient got neoadjuvant CTRT, you undergo surgery. If you have a pathological residual disease, you randomize in between nivolumab and placebo and the disease-free survival. And this is 22.4 versus 11 months. And nivolumab has been approved by the FDA for this particular indication 2 weeks back. So this result is definitely what medical oncologists called, you know, we were also ran. But I think, yes, and we immunotherapy is really going to go into the mainstream of esophageal cancers. So if I have to talk about esophageal cancers, the moment you have esophageal cancer, probably in an ideal world, we will like to give neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy, reassess after 4 to 6 weeks, do resection, pathological CR, leave, non-pathological CR, give adjuvant nivolumab for a year, and probably results are going to be fantastic. So that was all about squamous cell cancers. Now let's turn our attention towards the GE junction cancers, you know, and here, the moment I spoke about the GE junction cancers, I remember Shefali calling me up for the talk and telling me, sir, debate nahi hai. Aap na sirf dono points bada kar dena. I mean, people are so wary that I will turn this into a debate. So I am just going to tell you facts about neoadjuvant chemotherapy and neoadjuvant CTRT. So I said esophageal squamous cell cancer, NACTRT is predominantly much superior. Now, CAG junction is a different ballgame altogether. What is so special about the GE junction? The special thing is that the GE junction has been included in the gastric trials. It has been included in the esophageal cancers. So the gastric rationale is it has got a high risk of metastatic failure. It has got a high risk of locoregional failure. The esophageal rationale is there is a difficult to achieve R0 resection. And again, as I said, cure rate achieve 0% for an R1 resection. So people have given neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by adjuvant chemotherapy. People have also given chemoradiotherapy. So let's start. So there's always a tug of war between the thoracic oncologist surgeons and the GI surgeons. So Darlong versus Shivinder debate is always there in our institute. Now, did cross include people with CAG junction? Yes, it did. In fact, I did show you the initial data where more than 50% of the patient had distal esophageal, 25% had G junction cancers. And I showed you the graph initially where I showed you the squamous cell versus debate. The difference was huge. Now the difference in the G junction actually is not that high actually. And the difference is small. It is there. NACTRT is better, but only surgery also had a point. So let's go to the perioperative chemotherapy. So now there is no only neoadjuvant therapy. When I talk about G junction, I'm going to talk about perioperative chemotherapy. So this was a meta-analysis basically, which was which was published, and there was, you know, two main trials which came in this, the MAGIC trial and the ACCORD trial. And what this meta-analysis showed was that there is a benefit of neoadjuvant or a perioperative chemotherapy. And the difference was 9% at approximately 5 years. So that was a 9% OS advantage, was a huge advantage. And this is basically what has been predominantly going on in the West. So let's look at the MAGIC schema. People got 3 cycles of ECF resection, 3 cycles of ECF. Please see there was a continuous infusion of 5-FU in this for 21 days. The classical regimen which was used, this is not being used anywhere. But again, there was a 9% difference at 2 years, 13% difference in survival rate as compared to surgery alone. So definitely neoadjuvant or a perioperative chemotherapy works. Another trial, the FNCLCC and the FFCD, again, they got preoperative chemotherapy, 5-FU cisplatin, again versus surgery. Again, they found out 14% difference of between surgery and perioperative chemotherapy, and that led to the design. So if cross was a game changer, FLOT was FLOT was also a superb chemotherapy regimen. Here, what happened was people presumed that perioperative chemotherapy was the standard. They compared FLOT versus ECF or ECX into 3, resection and surgery, and then adjuvant chemotherapy. And this was again the PFS which was there, which was 18 versus 30 months. The HR was 0.75. This was the overall survival with an HR again of 0.77, of 50 months versus a 35 months advantage. So 15 months advantage in a adjuvant setting. Again, for my medical oncology friends, you know, I will tell how much advantage does trastuzumab give you? How much advantage does taxanes give you? It's just 5% advantage actually. And here you have a 15 months overall survival advantage, which is actually fantastic. The toxicity was there. We had a lot of hematological toxicity. I'll talk to you about that. Now, so I showed you data which was there between NACT. We also have data between NACTRT. So there was a trial which was called the POET trial and not Kumar Vishwas that I'm talking about. This was a trial in 2009. Now, this compared preoperatively chemotherapy versus chemoradiotherapy. And before Dr. Vinita jumps on this and says that NACTRT is better, please read. Again, for all the residents, you know, read the full paper. Don't go down the results. They wanted 355-4 patients. They got only 119. And that trial was terminated early. Any trial which has got a poor accrual, the results have to be taken with a pinch of salt. Now, again, they had preoperative chemotherapy versus CTRT and then surgery. And the results actually showed that the CTRT arm, the PCR rates were higher with the CTRT arm. But there was no, the study was underpowered to demonstrate a survival benefit. And the study was closed early. But in whatever data we have, CTRT was slightly better. So this was a slow accrual, and both the regimens were not the standard of care. This did not compare a flot versus a cross, which is what is being discussed in a trial right now. So how do you decide what to do today? You can do anything. It depends upon who is the most stronger person in your tumor board. If it's dash, 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 I will not raise the name, you will go for any CTRT. If it's a dash, 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 you will go for a neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So the issue over here is you look at the toxicity. Look at how frail or fit the person is. For a flot regimen, you do require a very strong person. You also want to see in this COVID era whether the patient will be able to come daily, whether they will be able to have a infusion, a cardiotoxicity. You have to see, because the toxicity-wise cross chemo radiation is slightly better. Very, very importantly, and please see over here, the treatment completion rate in flot was preoperative 90%, but postoperatively, we know how difficult is it to give chemotherapy postoperatively in flot, which was only 50%. That is also something which we have to see. 95% of patients did complete their chemotherapy in cross regimen, and not because Dr. Vinita is moderating that I'm saying, but the fight is very well open over there actually. So there's a trial which goes by the name of ISOPEC, which is comparing cross versus flot. The result should be expected in some time, 2-3 years, but by that time, the Bahubali in the tumor board might just win over there, or we'll discuss. We spoke about adjuvant nivolumab. Now let's see what future beholds for CAG junction adenocarcinomas. And this was, now we are moving about the TNT. We are moving towards TNT in CA rectum. We're also trying to move again towards TNT in CA stomach also, because again, we know giving post-operative treatment is slightly difficult. So maybe we'll start with neoadjuvant chemotherapy, give CTRT, and then go ahead with surgery. A very interesting concept, but the trials are going on. We do not know what is going to happen. Now, this was a trial which was the Petrarca study design. So what happens if you are HER2 new positive? If you are HER2 new positive and if you want to give neoadjuvant chemotherapy, will you add trastuzumab or not? How much trastuzumab will you add? We don't know. There was a Jacob trial which had added only trastuzumab to chemotherapy regimen. That was a negative trial. Now, this trial went and added Perjeta and trastuzumab. And this trial was presented at 2020 ASCO last year. And the PCR rates did increase from 12% to 35%. A 23% increase in PCR rate would have taken breast cancer to any other strategy. But the numbers are small. But I think we should consider it for somebody who can afford. The DFS and the OS was better in the chemotherapy plus the target therapy arm. So now, probably my last slide, I spoke to you about squamous cell carcinoma, but for adenocarcinoma, the ESMO guidelines say you have both the options available. You can actually go ahead with the perioperative chemotherapy. You can actually go ahead with the neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy. Maybe the radiation and the surgical oncologist should talk to each other. The bottom line is we need an R0 resection. In CA esophagus, gastroesophageal, if you do not get an R0 resection, I think all the jobs are not going to be done. We can fight it out, but in the end, it's a patient whose benefit we are all thinking about. So my conclusions on neoadjuvant therapy in gastroesophageal carcinoma, we started with medical oncologists being kept out of this, but now with the help of a lot of people, we are actually going and trying to go over the fence. But ultimately, I think it's the team because together we achieve more. The more survival, better we have, probably our patients will be happier, better. We will always be happy that it's all worth it. And before I end, this is my last message, especially to people in Delhi and Mumbai. Keep safe, keep well, please keep the faith. Jab achhe din nahi rahe, toh bure bhi nahi rahenge. And hope to see you all in person. Thank you. And thank you, Shefali, for giving me so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. As usual, crisp, clear, and punchliners, halaki kam the, but the definitely. So thank you for this very nice talk. So we'll be taking questions, sir, as usual. So our students and the audience, put up the question. The first question is, does the tumor abutment to aorta change the neoadjuvant protocol? So
I think it should. I think it should, you know. I mean, if you are your tumor which is abutting the radio, you will want more local control on that. I will probably go more towards the pre-op radiotherapy chemotherapy regimen. So I think it should. And that is where probably the tumor board will come in, or what Vinita will, Dr. Vinita will discuss.
Right. And second question is, suppose, I mean, in squamous cell mid-esophagus, there is a large field to cover. The supraclave is there and the distal esophageal, paraesophageal nodes are there. So would you consider giving a neoadjuvant chemotherapy regimen here vis-a-vis doing a neoadjuvant CTRT?
We do. Okay. Again, I think in the cross trial, they had not taken people who had more than 8 cm of the radiotherapy field. So if you have a large RT field, we typically give neoadjuvant chemotherapy, and then in 2-3 cases, we have even given NACT RT and then did surgery, and we have also done chemotherapy and then surgery after that. What I do not know is that whether to finish my neoadjuvant chemotherapy, the adjuvant chemotherapy after that, there is no role. I mean, you know, even in squamous cell carcinoma, if you have given any adjuvant, neoadjuvant regimen, even if you have a residual disease, you will not want to do anything. So then in those cases, I believe that we should give neoadjuvant chemotherapy, then probably CTRT and then do surgery. But I have done both.
So would you choose a neoadjuvant nivolumab in patients who landed up with either neoadjuvant chemo? I mean, being the fundamental that it works in squamous, or radiation is must for that effect. So that we want to understand.
I think, you know, being in oncology for a long time and having seen immunotherapy, you know, very up close, I will not like to make assumptions like this. I would actually want to go by data. You know, I mean, going again back to lung, let's go to back to breast. Neoadjuvant pertuzumab works exceedingly well. Adjuvant doesn't work. Probably adjuvant metastatic setting, nivolumab doesn't work. Pembro does work. And it's a patient life that we are playing with. It's the money which we are playing with. I would probably like to stick on to the data. That's what I would.
Right. Completely agree, sir. So, Dr. Nikhil, any other questions, or should we move forward to the
doctor? Esophagus mein bhi agar sare question medical oncology wale answer kar denge, to aap log kya karoge?
Bilkul, sir, bilkul. Par aapko aise nahi jaane denge. So, we have opportunity to hear from you. So, all questions will be directed. No worries.
Go ahead. Sandeep is there. I saw Sandeep here. Sandeep, hi. Can you
come in? सर ये सब आपकी वजह से है, ये पहली बार मेरे ख्याल से ऐसे लैंड अप किए हैं, क्योंकि आज आप आए हो, देख लो. सो वेलकम डॉक्टर बत्रा
जी. थैंक यू. एक्सीलेंट टॉक डॉक्टर उल्लास. बट टेल मी, अ पेशेंट विद जी जंक्शन एडिनो कार्सिनोमा कम्स टू यू टुडे. You will be starting with float, or you will be sending you to
your radiation oncologist? Today though I will not do anything. There are no beds. I will ask him to come back after 15 days.
Why not give a float and ask to come after 15 days?
Because there are no beds for float also.
No, you can do with the pump at the daycare.
So I would like to, I think we'll let Vinita take the question on that. I think let her take. I mean, there are a lot of things which come. What is the age? What is the field? How confident are the surgeons? It's not an easy answer. It was a very easy answer, Sandeep, before I read for this topic. It was actually float for everyone. But I think we'll have to choose horses for courses here now.
Yeah, I think I participated in a debate, float versus cross. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm saying, till the time it is a squamous cell carcinoma, a chemo radiation works better. But the moment it is adenocarcinoma, especially of the GE junction or stomach, float is more promising than cross. And I think Dr. Vinita will be conducting the panel. She might discuss more about that.
You're asking Vinita to say that surgery is better. Dream on, Sandeep.
No, not surgery, you know, better.
COVID getting over tomorrow. Impossible.
No, not surgery better, but chemo radiation followed by surgery rather than float followed by surgery.
Okay.
All right. So I think we should move ahead. So Dr. Nikhil will introduce the moderator and panel, I think. The surgeons have always a say. Dr. Nikhil will not let you keep quiet.
No. So I think it was a very interesting discussion, and Dr. Batra, Ullas Batra, Sandeep Batra is also there, hasn't left anything for anybody to say. He's just covered everything very briefly and very succinctly. So Dr. Batra, matlab, T2N0, what do you think?
T2N0, okay, fine. You have done an EOS, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so the data says anything more than T1, we would like to give pre-op CTRT, and especially with the data of adjuvant nivolumab coming up, I would be keen. to do that. However, yeah, you can say the benefit of a new adjuvant CTRT would be very dismal. But if the patient, so let's say I just put a cross question to you, Priya, you did T2N0M0.
I request all the participants to please mute themselves. There is a lot of disturbance, I think.
So let's say you have a T2N0N0 and you do not have a, you gave a pre-op CTRT and the patient did not achieve a PCR. You have an option now of giving adjuvant nivolumab. So I think I would move towards a pre-op RT-CT, but I'll be okay also if somebody did surgery first, if you're done a US after. There's no right
answer. Why can't we give nivolumab after completion of, say, adjuvant chemo if required?
Because there is no data, sir.
There's no data.
Let's talk about data. Actually, there is no data on that.
Actually, yeah, so the length of the this lesion would also matter. Simply T2N0 smaller versus a long length lesion, I think you would be keen to give a new adjuvant treatment rather than going for a upfront surgery. So
we have one question. What should be the length?
Can I ask Dr. Nikhil, does the length make a difference? Let's say it's a T. Okay.
No, your question, sorry, I was hearing that.
So, I mean, the point is, does the length of the disease make a difference to you as a surgeon?
No.
Yeah, so, I mean, surgeon ke liye koi farak nahi padta. Surgeon ko to bas T1, okay. T2 chahiye, kaat do.
So, we are very pro new adjuvant. We are very pro new adjuvant.
The data is too promising. You know, I will not like to deny anybody the advantage of that because there are surprises every time. And let's say you have done a good staging, EUS, everything, and let's say the node turns microscopic positive. And new adjuvant chemotherapy, radiotherapy, what is there against? 92% people completed. You have 81 months versus 40 months of every advantage, sir. The difference is huge. It's a fit individual. I would like to give that, sir.
Okay. Now we have a couple of questions here. So one question is from Sayyed Nusrat. What should be new adjuvant therapy for squamous cell carcinoma of GE junction extending to cardia and fundus with multiple nodes in perigastric, hepatogastric and celiac territories?
I will like to ask my surgeon, will you be able to resect it ever?
So technically, yes, we can do a esophagogastrectomy with colon pull-up.
If you think you can do that, I would like to give NACTRT for that.
Yeah, so I think CTRT should be the answer here.
I would do NACTRT for that, yeah.
Again, would field not matter? From G junction till cardia also involving and such a nodal burden. So Dr. Vinita, will you be comfortable in giving a radiation field to this tumor?
It looks doable to me. Whatever has been described in this, it looks doable because the G junction stomach and the celiac axis nodes, they are all within that same area.
I would also want actually to do an EUS and confirm all the lymph nodes. Again, in lung, when we do a lot of mediastinal lymph nodes and sometimes it comes as granulomatous and stuff like that, we actually confirm the most distal lymph node actually. Because a lot of times the seating does change. You do see, I mean, it's not like granulomas come only in lung cancer, it doesn't come into esophagus, it can actually.
But Dr. Batra, again, I would say that abdominal lymph nodes are a different ballgame than mediastinal lymph nodes.
Yes, absolutely.
Because preoperative EUS, if we start recommending for every patient, especially in a cost-constrained setting like us, that would be a little difficult because EUS FNA is an expensive investment.
How much? Can I ask you, how much will a US FNA cost?
40,000, sir.
20,000, that's it.
No, around 40,000.
How much will a radiation cost too? How much will a surgery cost?
So,
These are add-ons.
Yes.
Correct.
No, Dr. Vinita, why I'm telling you is, we have, it's easier to say we have, but we actually have seen tuberculosis. We have treated people on progression, then did not respond, did a biopsy, came out of tuberculosis. We have got some.
But the incidence is much lesser as compared to the mediastinal.
So, Dr. Batra, we can't talk about anecdotes when we decide. Look at the yield.
Sure. True that.
So I think with that, we are always short of time.
I think Dr. Rahul is saying something. Yeah, Dr. Rahul, please.
Very uncommon in CA G junction or CA stomach to get, tuberculosis along with malignancy. is very, very uncommon. Yeah. We do get, so we cannot rely on the fact, we cannot compare it with mediastinal nodes, as Dr. Nikhil said.
Sure. Totally agree with you.
So should we move on to panel?
Yeah, so with this, I think Dr. Vinita can take the floor, and Dr. Vinita, please take it forward.
So first of all, thank you, Dr. Shefali and Dr. Nikhil, for giving me this opportunity. And as expected, Dr. Ulas did a wonderful job. He, I think, clarified almost all aspects that I intend to discuss in today's panel discussion. However, let's threadbare and understand what are the practical issues which one faces while one has to treat these esophageal and gastric cancers. To begin with, I would like to invite all the experts who are with me in this panel discussion. Dr. Ulas Batra, everyone knows. Dr. Manoj Mahajan. Dr. Manoj Mahajan is a medical oncologist working at Pacific Medical College, Udaipur. Dr. Sameer Batham. Dr. Sameer Batham is a radiation oncologist at HCG Cancer Center, Ahmedabad. Dr. Arun Lal is joining us as a radiation oncologist from MVR Cancer Center, Calicut. Dr. Rahul, he's a GI surgeon at SGPGI, Lucknow. And Dr. Abhishek Anand. Shefali, is Dr. Abhishek there, or is he not there?
Dr. Manoj also is not there. He was contracted COVID positive. He was diagnosed COVID positive today. He dropped a message. Dr. Abhishek Anand is there, ma'am. I can see his name. Yeah.
Hi, Dr. Abhishek. Dr. Abhishek Anand is joining us as a medical oncologist from Paras Hospital, Patna. So I think without wasting time, we'll straight away come to our first case. And this is a real case. And I'm going to take you till the end, till how he's doing today. So it's a 68 years
old. Ma'am, you can make it full screen, I think.
I have already made it full screen, dear.
It's not coming full screen here, Dr. Vinita.
Oh.
Acha.
And the, yeah, and the very fact that the patient has lived for 44 years, that means the patient has done very, very well. 44 slides, one single patient, CA esophagus.
I think Dr. Sameer and Dr. Arun will have to say very little because Ulas is already in favor of chemo radiation. So is my slide visible as full screen now?
My guess, this is in presenter view, ma'am. You have to switch to a normal mode.
Ma'am, Apple use kar rahe ho?
एप्पल यूज कर रही
हूँ। वो बड़े आदमी है ना मैडम, वो छोटे आदमियों को उसमें आता नहीं है वहाँ पर।
मैं तो मैं कुछ डांट भी नहीं सकती हूँ, बहुत सारे लोग सुन
रहे हैं। I'm taking full advantage of that.
I think I'll start from here. It's a 68 years old gentleman who had no other comorbidities and he had a history of smoking in past. He was investigated for complaints of difficulty in swallowing food, which he had for last 4 months. And when he came to us, he was already on soft diet. There was a history of recent weight loss of about 3 kg in a month. He had no history of backache, there was no history of loss of appetite, and there was no history of change in the voice. I want to emphasize for the students in the audience that it is very important to take the history of backache and voice change, because by taking these positive or negative histories, you can assess how much locally advanced would the cancer be, you know, on the basis of the history. So please pay attention to these factors also. Clinically, this gentleman was well preserved. His weight was around 50 kg. And rest of the examination was unremarkable. And upper GI endoscopy showed that there was an obstructive eccentric lesion, which was at 30 to 33 centimeter. It was a stricturous lesion and the biopsy was squamous cell carcinoma. So after endoscopy, he straight away underwent a PET scan. And as you can see that he had a stricturing, narrowing lesion in the middle third or of the esophagus.
Dr. Vinita, ma'am, your slides are not moving.
Is it? Let me check on something.
मैम एक बार बंद करके ना, आपका शायद प्रेजेंटर मोड में है, आपको स्लाइड्स एक बार बंद करके दोबारा ओपन कर लीजिए.
ठीक है.
In that time that Dr. Vinita adjusts her screen, there's a question over here. Before the checkmate data for nivolumab, we used to tell people, okay, Dr. Vinita, you can go on. And then I think, yeah, it's now.
Ulas, is this fine now?
No, ma'am.
No, it is not. Okay. So then you carry on with your discussion. I'll change my
laptop. Okay, ma'am, aage. Abhi aapne pehle kuch kiya to aa gaya tha.
अभी आ गया है आई थिंक, पर फुल व्यू नहीं है अभी भी
मेरे में से नहीं आया है.
सो मैं लैपटॉप चेंज करती
हूं. डॉक्टर विनीता इफ यू कैन मेल मी द स्लाइड्स आई कैन प्रेजेंट.
नहीं सर मुझे दो मिनट दो, मैं अपना लैपटॉप दो मिनट.
आ गया जनी गया गया.
डॉक्टर लास्ट बत्रा क्वेश्चंस ले लेते हैं तब तक.
Change, change. I have to take the questions. I have changed because I'll take the questions. So there was this question about will we consider the patients for nivolumab in the adjuvant setting, considering that the cost will be 20-25 lakh rupees. I would actually counsel, you know, I mean it's an adjuvant setting, you're talking about a cure. You know, I mean, I now look like a fossil in front of all the youngsters. When the trastuzumab came and, you know, TCH came, one cycle, you know, one trastuzumab was 80,000 rupees. Docetaxel was 1,20,000 rupees. The cost of one cycle of TCH used to be around 2.5-3 lakh rupees. For the entire treatment, it was around 30 lakh rupees, and people still used to take it because it's an adjuvant setting. I think any improvement, although it's only a DFS improvement now, because then again, if you see residual disease, people who do not achieve a PCR. They are not going to do well. So I would probably be keen on at least offering them. Again, what I do in my practice is I kind of, you know, tell them ki, it's 3 milligram per kg body weight dose. We don't give them 240 milligram. So we say, okay, fine, up 100, 100, 200 le lijiye. Okay, I think Dr. Vinita is there. Ma'am is there.
Yeah, please complete, Dr. Patra, आप ये complete कर लीजिए, because this was one of the questions sent by. Yeah.
I do offer. I would be very keen to offer adjuvant nivolumab because it's a kind of, you know, it's an curative setting. It's not a palliative setting. I would want to discuss with the patient.
And 3 mg versus Dr. the Vinita, standard 240. 3 mg versus standard 240, sir.
So the data is the 240 mg, but the extrapolation, again, people will be very, very, you know, there has been no phase 3 data which has been there, which has compared 3 milligram versus 240 milligram. Even in lung, there have been only pharmacokinetic studies. But that's the data. In India, you will anyway get an approval only for 3 milligram per kg body weight. I would be absolutely okay. Again, you have to see the average weight of a Westerner is 80 kgs, and that is why it comes out to that. The average weight of an Indian guy will be around 50, 60. Esophagus will be around 50, 50, 60. So if we can give 60 into 3, 180, I'll be absolutely okay. I think Tata Memorial is doing a study where they're doing a low dose nivolumab also, but I will not like to tamper with the adjuvant setting. I would like to give go ahead with either a 3 or a 240.
Okay. So I'm sorry for the technical condition wastage of time. So the first case is a 68 years old gentleman. He had no comorbidities. He did have a history of smoking in past. He was investigated for difficulty in swallowing food, which he had for 4 months, and he was already on soft diet by the time he came to us. There was a history of recent weight loss, which was about 3 kg in last 1 month. There was no history of backache, no history of loss of appetite or voice change. So he underwent an upper GI endoscopy, which showed that, clinically he was well preserved. And upper GI endoscopy showed that there was an obstructive eccentric lesion at 30 to 33 centimeters. It was a stricturous lesion, and the biopsy from this was squamous cell carcinoma. This is the PET CT picture, sagittal view, which is showing that there was an FDG avid stricturous lesion in the mid third of the esophagus, not a very long lesion. It measured only 3 centimeters in line, and it had 0.9 centimeter thickness, and there were a few non-avid peri-esophageal lymph nodes. His cardiac workup and PFT were also reported to be normal. So I think these patients generally land up with a surgical oncologist. So I would like to ask Dr. Rahul. Dr. Rahul, this patient has a potentially operable squamous cell carcinoma of middle third esophagus. It's a localized disease. There are no lymph nodes. So what do you do with these patients? Do you offer them upfront surgery? Or do you offer them neoadjuvant treatment? Or any other investigations that you ask for? Here, I would also like to ask you that are these kind of patients discussed in your multidisciplinary tumor board or MTT, or, you know, you as a surgeon take a call, okay, this patient is operable, let me go ahead with surgery, or this patient needs a neoadjuvant chemo radiation therapy. So by this question, I mean that are medical and radiation oncologists a part of the discussion right from the beginning, or they just get to hear from you, you know, what do you think would be the right treatment?
Yes, we have a small tumor board which is headed by Dr. Rajneesh and Dr. Shalini. Dr. Shalini is from radiotherapy and Dr. Rajneesh as a surgeon. So all the upper GI cancers, whether it be CA esophagus or CA stomach, they are roped in into that tumor board right from the beginning. And it is a collective decision to go on operate or go with the chemotherapy or chemo radiation preoperatively. Usually the what we follow is we give neoadjuvant chemo radiation to all these patients and followed by surgery as the after the tumor has responded, maybe after after 6 to 8 weeks of the chemo radiation. And as far as this patient is concerned, you said that the patient had strictured with gastric features of dysphagia with weight loss. So if a patient is developing stricture, that means at least the muscularis and the maybe the adventitia is also involved. So after reviewing the CT, if we find that it is a T3 or T4 tumor, whether it be node negative or node positive, the patient should always undergo a preoperative chemo radiation. And this being a squamous cell carcinoma, I would offer an NACTRT. I would not offer, means it will be mostly it is decided by as a collective decision. It should be NACRT followed by surgery.
Any role of EUS or when do you ask for EUS in your practice? I mean, considering that it is not looking very advanced.
Yes, had it been an early tumor, as you said, I said stricture always amounts to a T3 or T4 lesion. It cannot be with just a T2 lesion that you will develop, that the patient will develop a significant stricture. So EUS may be advised in these patients if it is, if we have to decide upfront surgery. As if there are no nodes and nothing like of that sort, then US can be advised. But in this patient, NACRT will be a treatment modality as an initial step. So US can be plus minus depending upon the availability, depending upon the patient's affordability as well.
May I ask Dr. Arun Lal, radiation oncologist in the panel. Dr. Arun, would you offer this patient radical CTRT? This is an operable patient, but a small lesion. Do you think that this patient will do as well with radical CTRT as he would do with CTRT followed by surgery? And what is the status of use of radical CTRT in the present scenario? Dr. Arun, are you there? Or maybe if he's not there, then Dr. Yeah, Sanu can take
it. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Hi, Arun.
Yeah. Definitely, he has two options, as rightly mentioned. He can either go for a neoadjuvant chemo radiation followed by surgery, or he can be taken up for chemo radiation as a definitive protocol. This is a low volume disease. He's 68 years. Definitive chemo radiation makes equal sense. In our practice, at least, the cutoff is somebody who has an age more than 65 or somebody who has more than two comorbidities. These are the situations where we try to avoid surgery because in the best of hands, there is a 4% mortality with esophagic. Having said that, his stricture is one thing that we have to keep in mind. So if he has already a stricture at presentation, his quality of life will be far better with surgery. So that's a fact. So I think he has the fact that he has no comorbidities, he's just 68. He's a reasonably fit patient. 30 to 33 centimeter NACRT followed by surgery will be the decision of the tumor board in most of the time.
Dr. Arun shouting loud in his presentation about a median survival of 84 months after CTRT followed by surgery. Do you think with radical CTRT we can get that kind of survival?
It's difficult to say because at least the survival, I haven't looked at the German data, but at least the survival of the FFCT trial was far lesser. That I am sure. I think it was around 30 months, 28 months, somewhere similar. So the highest survival in a squamous cell carcinoma, the protocol that gave the highest survival in a squamous cell carcinoma is the CROWS protocol. So in a fit patient, that always becomes the standard. As I said, it depends upon the socioeconomic profile. Age is a cutoff for us. So somebody who is on the other side of 65, we are cautious. Somebody who is more than 70, although CROWS, I think the age of the patient went up to 76 in the CROWS protocol. But then somebody who is more than 70, we rarely offer them NACRT followed by surgery in practice.
So So we did for this patient that he had a hetero-echoic lesion at 32-33 centimeters, which was breaking through muscularis properly and at places through adventitia also. There was no invasion of the surrounding structures. There was no lymphadenopathy. So his final stage was T3N0.
Can I
ask
you one question, Dr. Vinita? How frequently are we doing EUS for, in general, everybody's practice, because we don't do actually much.
Very valid question. Dr. Rahul, would you answer that? When would you do EUS for a patient?
Yes, sir. US usually at our center, US is not a very common in at least T3, T4 tumors. But yes, if it is an early tumor, then US to assess the size of the T lesion, the T staging. And if there is if it is an early tumor and you want to do really, we want to go ahead with surgery straight away, then US to evaluate for local nodes if there are any which can be positive and which may amount to preoperative chemoradiation or chemotherapy followed by surgery. So these are the two major indications for US, and especially if there is a stricture and you dilate and do an US, that is a difficult situation to manage if the patient develops perforation. So US is basically used at our center only for early tumors, which are a rare finding to actually find.
How commonly, everyone, Dr. Vinita, in your practice, how commonly percentage?
So I think US, as Dr. Rahul correctly said, is a problem-solving tool when you have a very early stage esophageal or rectal cancer, where you're wondering whether to treat this patient with a single modality, which is surgery upfront, versus whether to add any neoadjuvant therapy or not. So since this patient had a short segment of disease, there were no lymph nodes, that is when we thought, but as Dr. Rahul correctly said, that probably it was not required, because by the look of the lesion, we knew that it has to be at least T2 to T3.
So generally, because in our practice, we don't do much. Honestly.
So less than 10% of our patients.
Very rare. I agree with Dr. Ulas.
Majority patients have advanced tumors.
Yeah.
Majority patients do not have this kind of early presentation. This was a doctor's father. That is why, probably got picked up early. So Dr. Rahul, coming back to you again. So when you see these patients, which are the factors you consider, or Dr. Arun has already mentioned that if a patient has an age of more than 70 years, more than two comorbidities, then these patients are not considered very fit for multimodality therapy, especially surgery. So what are the factors that you consider for fitness for multimodality therapy? How do you decide?
The most important is nutrition of the patient. So before starting any treatment, we have to assess the nutrition. So usually we assess it by general well-being of the patient, general appearance, the presence or absence of pedal edema, and apart from that, the laboratory markers like albumin and blood counts as well, the platelet count. Because a patient at the age of 70 years, he may have subtle chronic liver disease as well, because of NASH, because of diabetes and this. So these things we do assess as before starting treatment, and other things are comorbidities. So until unless the patient is considered fit for a multimodality therapy, we do not go ahead with it.
I think that is fair enough. And but I would also like to add that at times, for the sake of students in the audience, some of these patients are considered for PEG tube placement for building up on nutrition. I can see Dr. Nikhil's face, but Dr. Rahul, would you agree that should a PEG tube placement be considered, not considered? At times, gastroenterologists, very enthusiastically, they would put in a stent, So what are your takes on stenting and PEG tube?
Yes, the best method to feed is enteral, that is well known. But PEG as a method for feeding in a case of CA esophagus is not a very good idea. We should always, try to access the jejunum, whether it be surgical or be put a Ryle's tube in the stomach, and then we start feeding. But when we do a PEG, then actually we may be, disturbing the organ which can be taken up as a conduit during the surgery later on. So PEG as a method, modality of enteral feeding, I will not promote. what we do usually here is we put a NG or a NJ, and usually we put an NG for a patient with CA esophagus. We put a NG, either it be radiological guided or be endoscopically guided. And then we start feeding the patient slowly, and as he builds up, we plan for the further treatment. And most of these patients, when they undergo neoadjuvant therapy, they actually, the tumor melts out and they start taking orally as well. So dysphagia improves after, you know, 28 to 30 days of preoperative therapy, then the patient starts taking on his own. So PEG as a modality is not actually advised in patients with CA esophagus.
So a very strong and a loud message again that a PEG tube has to be avoided at all costs. And I can see that our surgical oncologists and medical oncologists are developing a lot of confidence in this NACTRT protocol. They are accepting that after a few days of radiation and chemotherapy, generally patients get relief in their dysphagia. What if some patients have a stent in situ? Does it make any difference to your surgery later on? And would you advocate a stent or not?
Stent, as far as it should be avoided, because stent does create local inflammation and it may affect surgery. But I as a surgeon have not experienced much too many cases with stent in place, because usually we get away with a placement of a tube, or maximum if the tube is not it cannot be placed, then we do an FJ while doing a staging laparoscopy. We do a FJ at that time only, at the same time, in the same setting. So stent I have not seen till time. I think Dr. Nikhil
I would rather ask Dr. Vinita this question, because my understanding so far is that radiation oncology colleagues are more wary about preoperative stents.
We hate stents.
Yeah, agreed.
So yeah. In addition to medical oncologists.
Radiation gets extremely difficult.
No, Dr. Batra, medical oncologists love stents.
No. She said we hate stents. I said radiation oncologists hate stents in addition to medical oncologists.
Dr. Nikhil, does surgery become more difficult once the patients have stents in situ? Because as Dr. Rahul said, that it causes a lot of local inflammation.
So not really, Dr. Vinita, because as a preoperative modality, we have never used stenting because we don't give radiation after that. In fact, we had to operate a couple of patients who were stented somewhere else, and then somebody gave radiation. And I mean, put together, everything was very difficult. But now, if radiation is given and stenting is done, that itself is a very toxic combination. So I don't think that's a good idea.
Dr. Vinita, I'll ask you, because let's say somebody has been, a stent has been inserted outside, the patient comes to you, a PET scan is done, it's a localized disease. Now, if a stent would not have been put, you want to give a pre-op CTRT. Now, would you ask for a stent removal, or can you give, radiotherapy on top of that stent? Because some of my radiation oncology friends said, wo stent tightness ho jayega. Half the people say ki yaar nahi nahi de sakte hain, koi data hai. So what would you do?
So Dr. Arun, would you like to take up this question? Stenting and radiation therapy, how difficult or easy is it for you?
Very good moderator, passing on the buck.
To be honest, I haven't faced that situation, so you'll be better able to explain. But there are two issues, as ma'am rightly mentioned. One is that the contouring becomes difficult because you have no real idea where the DDB is going to be, because the whole thing gets distorted. Unless you have a very good pre-op image and there is not much of a gap between the pre-stenting image, and there's not much of a gap between the pre-stenting image and the planning, we may get away. But then contouring becomes difficult. You can't identify the GTV properly. You'll always have to over-contour. You'll have to probably treat more esophagus. That is what is going to happen. That will be one issue. There are dosimetric issues. Especially this being, if it become, it, usually it will become, it will be a medicine. So that is another concern. So the there is issues with the calculation of the dose as well as the dose deposition. So there will be slightly more dose that will be deposited to the mucosa at certain points. So these issues are there. So I haven't faced that issue, but then practically speaking, I hope I won't face it.
I have been with So I find that it creates challenges for both patients as well as treating oncologists.
Can we go ahead with sequential type of therapy? Like we start with a single cycle of chemotherapy, then we go ahead with the neoadjuvant chemo radiation.
It won't be anything, Abhishek. Abhishek, it won't change anything. The stent is there inside every night.
No, no, if there is a problem with the planning of the radiation, then we can remove the stent after giving one cycle of chemotherapy, then we can go ahead with the...
My understanding, Abhishek, is the more you keep the stent inside, it will get embedded, it will become difficult to remove also. I mean, that's my understanding. I think if
so, I'll just add one point here about, because these stents are bare metal stents and mostly they cannot be removed.
Correct. So majority stents cannot be removed.
Yeah.
The challenge that we face as a radiation oncologist in giving radiation therapy to these patients is that these patients continue to have a lot of pain. They have a lot of reflux. There is always a chance of stent migration. So it is not that radiation is absolutely contraindicated, but giving radiation therapy definitely gets much more difficult. And majority of these patients are not candidate, at least for double agent chemotherapy. Even if we give them chemo radiation, it has to be single agent and not double agent. And one has to be ultra careful in giving radiation therapy to these patients. So I think moving forward, we've already discussed, Dr. Rahul emphasized that the nutritional status of the patient is very important whenever any patient is being planned for multimodality therapy. And the best way to look at it is the albumin levels and the other levels that you look for. And it is very important to maintain that nutritional level. And the simplest way to do it is a nasogastric tube rather than going for fancy things like stenting or PEG tube. PEG tube is an absolutely big no-no. So I think Dr. Ulas has already emphasized that the results of NACT-RT are, as shown in the cross trial, are much better. So I just want to emphasize that the PAD-CR rate in squamous cell carcinoma in the cross trial was 49%, which means some of the surgeons in future are probably going to run out of their business of surgery. One out of two patients was getting PAD-CR. So it's actually a game-changing trial. But a lot of there are two main caveats in this trial, that only 23% of the patients had squamous cell carcinoma, and it is the comparison of surgery alone and not NACT-RT followed by surgery versus NACT followed by surgery. So I would like to ask Dr. Anand here that what is your take on preoperative chemo radiation therapy for esophageal carcinoma? Do you practice that or do you consider NACT one cycle, two cycle, then CT-RT or NACT followed by surgery as you just now mentioned?
So if the performance status of the patient is quite good and preserved, then we definitely start with pre-operative chemo radiation and then followed by surgery. However, many patients come with the poor performance status. In such scenario, we sometimes start with the one or two cycles of chemotherapy. Then we, as the performance status improves of the patient, then we go ahead with the chemo radiation and then surgery.
So what makes you think that the performance status of the patient will improve after one or two cycles of chemotherapy?
Yeah, definitely.
The performance status is down because of poor nutritional status. I'm sure radiation therapy would make it better, faster, you know, than NACT.
Yeah, definitely, sir. So both are the options. And if you see the trials, NACT versus NACT-RT, NACT-RT has fared better as compared to NACT. So NACT-RT is the preferred option. But sometimes the patients are not very much willing for radiation upfront. And this is the practical situation what we are facing here. So
I agree that in COVID scenario, maybe some of the patients are not willing to come for everyday treatment. But if you find that any patient who's not willing to come for radiation therapy, send them to your radiation oncology colleague to convince them. You know, discuss them in the multimodality rather than, you know, taking the decision by yourself. Dr. Sameer, your comments and what is your practice? Do you practice concurrent preoperative, concurrent CT-RT followed by surgery, or your surgeons prefer upfront surgery or NACT or whatever?
Ma'am, in our institute, all the esophagus patients we see in MDT only, and all these patients they go this preoperative cross only. This is a standard approach.
Okay, wonderful. Dr. Arun, what is your practice?
I don't think
CT-RT or pre-op chemotherapy.
Any squamous cell carcinoma definitely goes for neoadjuvant chemo radiation or definitely chemo radiation. I don't think I have come across any patients in human board which has gone for neoadjuvant chemo alone in the recent past at least. Adeno, I think we will come to adeno later, but adeno at times we take a call depending upon the situation.
So I think as Dr. Ulas Batra correctly said that this trial was a game changer, and we find that majority centers across India have adopted this trial into their practice. Dr. Ulas, I'm coming back to you. You mentioned about this trial NeoTrek. So what chemotherapy do you use as a concurrent, in the concurrent setting, in the pre-op therapy?
For weekly baclicarbo.
Baclicarbo.
Weekly baclicarbo.
Weekly baclitaxel carbo. Yeah. Okay.
And you know, I'll just tell you once again, this is the data from the West. I think Dr. Kundan and Dr. Irfan from our edition team are actually analyzing the data of whatever has happened in Rajiv Gandhi. And they have actually seen a platonic shift from 2014. Now, 2012 was the time when Cross was published. We took a year and a half to adopt to that. From 2014, 2015, the results have been phenomenally fantastic. So we have actually, you know, the data is actually replicated in our scenario. They are going ahead with a publication also on that.
Very heartening to listen to that. Dr. Ulas, as I know you, you're very passionate about treating lung cancers. I'll tell you how I became passionate about treating esophageal cancers. We started practicing pre-op CTRT at Max Hospital at my institution in 2009, even before the phase 3 trial was out. And, you know, initial 5 patients, when 3 of them had PAT CR, I said, what am I doing? And that time we were not even using paclitaxel carboplatin. We were using only concurrent cisplatin. So the data is quite moving, I think. So you mentioned about, Dr. Ulas, about POET trial also. Would you agree with the statement that I've written here, that radiation looks almost unavoidable, non-negotiable in a preoperative setting? I'm talking only about squamous cell carcinoma of the middle third esophagus or lower third esophagus.
Totally agree, madam.
Okay.
After the thrashing you gave to someone else, I totally agree.
You have little choice. Another question is that, do you think this trial reflects what you said, we are going more towards TNT approach, total neoadjuvant therapy approach?
I would actually want to, you know, the problem with both rectum and definitely CS, esophagus and stomach is it will be difficult to give post-operative radiotherapy. Absolutely. And all the trials actually are saying that, you know, the critics and the other artist trial are saying that, you know, the post-op things are not very good. So to me, neoadjuvant chemo, the best of all the words, neoadjuvant chemotherapy, neoadjuvant RTCT, neoadjuvant chemotherapy, then surgery. The point is you want to increase the PCR rate and you want to have more people completing the treatment. I think the TNT approach would be good actually.
Yeah, even I think in times to come, we will move towards TNT approach the way we are moving towards it in the rectal cancers.
Yep.
Dr. Rahul, I'm coming back to you, our surgical oncologist in the on board. So when you're sending your patients for preoperative surgery, what worries you? Are you worried about non-compliance for surgery? Or are you worried that post-CTRT your patients might have more morbidity and they might not become fit for surgery? Or you expect more difficulty in performing surgery or increase in the post-operative complications? Or are you absolutely okay to send your patients for preoperative CTRT?
So as I said, it is always a collective decision to send a patient for NACTRT. Yes, definitely post-CTRT, the surgical difficulties do increase. The dissection increases, the chances of anastomotic dehiscence increases. So these all problems are always there. And many a times we do get patients who have a low platelet count or a low TLC at the time of assessment prior to the surgery. So this is very, very common, the hematological complications, though they are not very obvious, but they do tend to affect the outcome of the surgery. But the good thing is that these patients who land up in the for surgery, who actually are fit for surgery, we do get R0 resections. And the other good thing is that these patients do improve on nutrition following the CTRT.
So what is the time interval or the window between completion of CTRT and surgery that you generally observe?
Usually we want it to be 6 to 8 weeks, maybe 8 weeks, but every time it is not possible because of logistic issues at times because of this complications like a patient having a platelet count of 75,000 or 70,000 at the time of reassessment, and we have to wait for some time and then reassess or give some, platelet boosters and then reassess after 2 weeks. So usually we want it after 8 weeks, but every time it doesn't happen.
Do your problems or the surgical complications increase when you're waiting for more than 8 weeks? Do you experience more fibrosis and more difficulty in identifying the fat planes, etc.?
As a surgeon, I would say yes. The surgical difficulties do increase, as I said. But Dr. Rajneesh is there. I think he will be a better person to answer this question. I think he is there. He wanted to answer a few questions, and Dr. Nikhil may also rope in to tell about this. But yes, theoretically, the fibrosis should increase. But it doesn't matter much, you know, edema comes down.
chance. Okay. Another last question from you, Dr. Rahul. What is the anastomotic complication rates that you see? Less than 10%, 10 to 20%, 30%, 50%? How high is that?
I think 10 to 15% down here.
Is it? Oh, that's pretty high. And how about pulmonary complications?
Pulmonary complications to occur, that also amounts around 20%, 10 to 20%. In between that, it varies.
Dr. Nikhil, do you want to add anything to this?
So I would want to add one that, yes, as the duration increases, our fibrosis increases and surgical difficulty increases. One, like after 7 weeks, it starts increasing and our difficulty increasing. And we have seen this in salvage esophagectomy. That is a very, very difficult surgery to do. With a very high morbidity. And leak rate, generally, I mean, if you look at the data, world literature, that is around 3%, but we see slightly higher leaks, right? But then I actually haven't calculated recently, but when we used to do it as part of our training, there we have analyzed data at that point of time, and it was around 5-6% kind of number. And pulmonary complication, again, like it all depends on which Clavien Dindo pulmonary complication we are talking about. If we, you know, say grade 1-2 complications, that is fairly common. But with the advent of VATS, I'm a huge fan of VATS in esophageal surgery, because the major problem with esophageal surgery was pulmonary complication. And that was the debate between transthoracic and transhiatal surgery. And there were many proponents of transhiatal surgery. Now, VATS had changed the game completely. So the pulmonary complication has significantly gone down. And I mean, it has made it very, very easy for the patients.
Okay, Dr. Nikhil, I just want to add a point here. You said that the salvage surgery in esophagus is very difficult and very different. I would say that when you're doing a salvage, majority of these patients have earlier got something like 60 gray. Compared to in pre-op CTRT, where the dose ranges from 40 to 45 gray, maximum will be 50 gray. And that 15, 20 gray will certainly make your surgery much more difficult. So salvage surgery versus delayed surgery, I think will be a little different experience.
So in our institute, the surgeons want the patient to come to 4 weeks. 4 weeks, one guy says 4 to 5 weeks, some guy says 5 to 6 weeks. And the second thing is, again, the data, we actually have after RTCT, around 20 to 30% dropout. People don't come for surgery. So well, that is also
the issue also, the issue of non-compliance in the Indian. Yes.
So that is an issue.
So okay. That was the salvage surgery I was talking about, Dr. Vinita, when they recur and then they come.
Okay, got it. That's wonderful. So I'm coming back to my radiation oncology colleague, Dr. Sameer is there. Dr. Sameer, when you see these patients, they are referred to you by a surgical oncologist after discussion in MDT. How do you yourself assess, you know, rather than relying on a surgeon's assessment, how do you assess whether you think that the patient is fit for CTRT followed by surgery, tri modality or not? Do you ask them some simple measures or questions?
For me, the assessment starts right when the patient comes to my OPD. First thing is the performance status, of course. The nutrition status, how is he taking, whether he's able to take even semi-solid or whether he can take liquids or not. So this is the first thing which he assesses, which we usually assess in our team. Then how the most important thing, and particularly when we are dealing with a pre-op case, is how motivated he is for this entire treatment. This is a long therapy. We have to explain them that this is a pre-operative therapy and the final treatment will be by surgery only. So a long counseling session is must, and which is what we practice at our institute. And other than that, the routine investigations and everything that we do, we from day one only, we keep our nutritional counselor in our loop, and the patient is under constant watch. As I said, it was discussed that we usually do not prefer any prophylactic peg or a stent as the dysphagia, even if they have, we usually wait for a week or so. And most of the time, after a week or so, they have a significant relief in dysphagia. So this is how we proceed.
I have kept this question keeping in mind that, you know, when a patient lands up in a radiation oncology OPD, from there, we have about 3 months till the patient reaches the surgeon's operation theater.
Yeah.
So it is our duty, it is our responsibility as radiation and medical oncologists that in these 3 months, we try to build up their nutrition as well as physical fitness. So we must emphasize and continue emphasizing the importance of good nutritional diet, including high protein diet for these patients, as well as encourage them to improve their physical fitness, especially the lung fitness, by doing a regular spirometry, going for a brisk walk, etc. It is our responsibility.
Yes.
And at the same time, we must counsel them correctly that radiation therapy is not going to finish their treatment. Yeah. They have to mandatorily complete the treatment by undergoing surgery to reduce the issue of non-compliance as much as possible, which Dr. Ullas has already discussed about.
Absolutely, absolutely.
When these patients are coming to you, Dr. Arun, then the surgeon expects that the patient would safely go back for surgery. They are worried about pulmonary complications and anastomotic complications. So how do you prevent or deal with them?
As you rightly mentioned, I think we have to take responsibility for certain things. And I'm happy that you mentioned this, because every weekly review, the emphasis is that there is going to be a surgery. This is the best time. This is a planned surgery. This is not an emergency surgery. You have to continue your spirometry. You have to continue to build up. And generally by 2 weeks, they come to our track. Last week and the week after, they'll have the dysphagia of the treatment. And after that, they get better. That is what is happening. Specific question regarding the pulmonary complications. We keep the B20 less than, I think we'll come to that. The lung dose constraints has to be met, both the high dose and the low dose. So that has to be met. And more than that 8 centimeter cutoff that was used in CROWS, what we practically look at is the lung constraint. So as long as we meet the lung constraint, he's a candidate for treatment. So in patients in whom we met the lung constraint, we haven't had, we meet the lung constraint and we haven't had as much as pulmonary complication, even as the literature says. I don't have the hard data. Regarding the anastomotic leak, again, by now we know that the fundus of the stomach has to be spared. At least the 30 gray dose to that area has to be avoided as much as possible. That can be very well done for our usual squamous cell malignancies. In G-junction tumors, of course, that becomes again another concern at times. Technique, I don't routinely use VMAT. If at all I am using intensity modulation, it will be a fixed beam IMRT, because with VMAT, my low dose still will be 2 minutes. So it will be definitely a fixed beam IMRT. Or at times I would 3D. In the retrocardiac esophagus is where IMRT definitely has a far better route. It is slightly higher. I might get away with the 3D also. And the dose, the patient's not reaching the surgery. It has happened to us for, I think, 3 out of 15 patients. It has not been the patient's fault. Sometimes the anesthesia had some issue at that point of time. So these sort of things happen. I give 45 gray, not 41.4 as per the thing. I know that many of us give 50.4 gray. So that is my one bias. I give at least 45 gray so that something is covered. And in the 3 patients, by 4 weeks, when I knew that surgery was not a part of the plan, I gave ILRT 5 gray into 2 fractions and then asked them to take 2 more cycles of chemo. That was the best thing that I could do from that point of time, once surgery was out of the picture. Mainly due to the from the anesthesia side, the surgery was out of the issue, not from a patient motivation issue. So that is how I did it.
So I think Dr. Arun has answered, given us a lot of messages. First message is that to emphasize on the spirometry. The second message is to emphasize on the compliance. The patient has to be repeatedly reminded that this is not the end of the treatment. Even if your dysphagia improves, it is a planned surgery which the patient has to undergo. As far as radiation techniques are concerned, it is okay to do 3D CRT as well as IMRT, but we avoid rotational IMRT, something like rapid arc, VMAT or tomotherapy in some of these patients as far as possible, although it can be a institutional practice. I know Sameer practices a lot of tomotherapy for these patients. He and I also believe in it, that I don't do rotational IMRTs to avoid the low dose of radiation going through the lung. But in the retrocardiac area, it is imperative to do IMRT. Now in this picture, what I'm trying to show to some of our radiation oncology colleagues here is that the fundus of the stomach is actually used as a distal loop for anastomosis with the cervical esophagus. And this is the part of the fundus of stomach which one can spare with radiation therapy if one is aware about it. If the fundus of the stomach is spared, then the anastomotic complications in these patients are by far much lesser than how they used to be earlier. Another very critical issue is about the total doses. Although the CROWS trial, which Dr. Ullas was repeatedly alluding to, gave only 41.4 gray majority of us give 45 to 50 gray to these patients, keeping in mind that we expect that 20% of the fallout will be there, 20% of the patients might not be compliant for radiation therapy. And if you ask people who work in the Western universities, they also have the same issue of non-compliance. And in MSKCC, in fact, they give 50.4 gray even in pre-operative CTRT protocol to all their patients, so that even if they do not land up for surgery, they have received a reasonable dose of radiation therapy. Dr. Samir, here. Yeah, hi.
My problem would be giving paclicarbo along with the dose of 50.4 gray radiotherapy, because then the dose of paclicarbo will become very toxic. I mean, that's my, you know, because we also do discuss
problem with
this.
Chemotherapy, it is very toxic. You have accepted it.
The problem here is, madam, that the medical oncologists are practicing evidence-based medicine. Radiation oncologists are practicing eminence-based medicine. You know, you use a Western name. That's a problem.
No eminence-based practice here. No eminence-based practice. There is ample of literature there also. People have used a slightly higher dose of radiation therapy. See, again, the last one is important is, last very important is that it is not 60 gray.
I showed you in my data also that less than 55 gray is more than, I understand that. But the point is, ma'am, I do not know of any literature.
Influenced by the POET trial. In POET trial, they've given only 30 gray in 15 fractions.
And that is why, madam, in
studies where they have given only 40 gray in 20 fractions. So I started left, right, center practicing 41.4 gray. And I thought that anyone who is giving more than 41.4 gray with two drugs is absolutely wrong. But when I looked at the non-compliance rate, that is when we slightly changed. I actually honestly give 45 in 25. I don't do 50 unless the tumor is very big. And even if I'm giving 50, I will give it to a very, very small volume, only to the gross tumor, not to the entire big volume. I know the person has to be safely sent for surgery later on.
It would be nice to have a look at the data about what we are doing and then come out with the answer, ma'am. There are postgraduate residents listening to this.
I completely take your point, Dr. Ulas, here. And the standard dose with two drugs will be with paclicarbo will be 41.4 gray, as shown by the cross trial.
What about the bulky nodes, ma'am? Do you boost them or you give additional dose?
Maybe I don't. No bulky nodes are given additional dose. Swami, I wanted to ask you a question here. Yes. Suppose you had a patient who had poor lung function. However, the surgeon thought that he or she would still be a candidate for surgery. Do you have any other better techniques of radiation therapy? I want to hear about DIBH and proton therapy.
Ma'am, frankly, we
remember that proton therapy is not available to everyone, while DIBH may be available to more people.
Yes, ma'am. So we don't have 4D CT or we do not practice DIBH at our center. What max we do is we try to at least these patients who have lung issues, I don't take them on tomo. I prefer IMRT at least. And sometimes I try to make some hybrid plans. So it's all about, you know, it's a juggling between V20 and V5. And we try to do our best how less we can achieve, especially the V5 in these patients.
Suppose you have a patient who's affording, there are no financial issues, can go for proton therapy. Yes. Do you think proton therapy gives you an additional advantage, and what advantage do you get with it?
Ma'am, theoretically, definitely it has advantages.
I know.
I don't have any practical or front.
Arun, any comments?
Ma'am, if they have a poor lung function, they won't be a candidate for a neoadjuvant chemo radiation. From a definitive point of view, when we are treating, we have access to ABC, but I don't remember an patient of esophagus whom I have used ABC. Regarding the proton part, there is a large amount of literature, especially coming from the MD Anderson group. They have used a very complicated terminology, the total toxicity burden, the TTB, will be far less when you are using a proton. In fact, that article, when I first read that article, what I told to many of my colleagues is, this is how the medical oncology articles on various the molecular, all those sort of graphs they have shown. And eventually that the total toxicity burden is the new terminology that they have come up, is comparatively less with proton. It will definitely reduce the lung dose. That much we can accept, but how much it will affect? It's a phase 2B trial from the MD Anderson. I think there are phase 3 trials recruiting for the same purpose. So we'll wait and
see. Phase 3 trials are recruiting, but then there are sufficient studies which have shown that proton therapy have an edge over photon therapy, even in preoperative setting for carcinoma esophagus, because in proton therapy, you can reduce the cardiac dose, which sometimes you cannot reduce in your photon plans. And the cardiac morbidity-induced deaths are by far less in the proton therapy-treated patients. I had a patient who was earlier treated for breast cancer and later on had a carcinoma esophagus who required preoperative chemoradiation therapy. That is when I ventured into DIBH to save her lungs. So I think that's another option that we have to reduce the doses to the lung as well as the heart. So this is how we treated this patient. We gave him preoperative CTRT with concurrent paclitaxel and carboplatin. And we gave him 45 grain, 25 fractions over 5 weeks. And we used this kind of beam arrangement. We avoided rotational IMRT. This is how the 100% dose wash looked like. 50% looked like this and 25% looked like this. In fact, I was quite happy with the plan. I'll show you the DVH also by my radiation oncology colleague. My mean lung dose was 14 gray. V5 was 60%. V20 was 33%. I was quite happy with it. But still, what happened was that patient had persistent cough after completion of radiation therapy. And this was his PET scan, which was done at 6 weeks after completion of CTRT. And it showed that there were changes in the lung. And these changes in the lung actually correlated with the low isodose wash. Ulas, I have specifically kept this question for you here. I call this as chemo radiation induced pneumonitis. Do you agree or do you pass the buck only to the radiation oncologist?
There's no, I don't pass the buck. It is only radiation induced pneumonitis. Chemotherapy is just an innocent bystander. although paclitaxel can cause drug induced pneumonitis, it's okay. We give steroids.
I agree with you. We give steroids. But the point that I'm trying to make is that this incidence of radiation pneumonitis has definitely increased once we've started using concurrent paclitaxel.
So, ma'am,
a case for both lung cancers as well as esophageal cancers. Yes.
And the point is that if you give 41.4, the incidence is lesser. And if you give 50.4 RT and give paclitaxel, the incidence is even higher. That is why I was telling you that, you know, the moment we give, so we cannot use a half cross, super cross trial with esophageal surgery. The plan has to be made in advance. So that was my reservation against going ahead with the 50 or a 45 dose.
Okay, fine. Fair enough. So as the radiation dose increases, the incidence of radiation pneumonitis increases. But the point is that it is not only radiation-induced pneumonitis. If you were to give this patient only cisplatin or only carboplatin or cisplatin 5-FU, then the incidence of pneumonitis is not very high. I have already shown it here. Arun, do you agree with this management protocol for radiation pneumonitis?
Absolutely, ma'am. And in your case, he was symptomatic. Many a time we see it on the scan, but we don't acknowledge it because patient is asymptomatic and we just leave it. But this is what we should be doing.
So I have kept this purposefully because a lot of even surgeons do not know that this can be a time for pneumonitis, radiation and chemo-induced pneumonitis. So they keep thinking that unnecessarily why this patient is having cough, or the patients keep getting a lot of antibiotics, which do not help. So I think if your patient is having a lot of cough or breathlessness after completion of chemo-radiation therapy, please speak to your radiation oncology colleague and they will help you sort out this radiation pneumonitis if at all it is there. So coming to Dr. Mahajan, I want to ask you a question. Am I correct in your name?
Yes, ma'am, he's not there. He is COVID positive. So Dr. Manoj Mahajan is not there today.
Dr. Abhishek Anand is there.
Yeah.
Dr. Abhishek, do you give double agent to all your patients or are there patients who get single agent concurrent chemotherapy also? I'm talking about fitness of Indian patients.
So I think most of the patients are tolerating well the dual agent paclitaxel. So most of the patients we are giving a double agent paclitaxel only along with the radiation.
Dr. Ulas, any comments?
No. I mean, if a patient is fit enough to take radiotherapy, he's fit enough to take chemotherapy.
That's a wonderful comment. I don't agree with that also. We have a couple of
patients. Yeah, because most of the patients are unfit to take radiotherapy.
postgraduates who are listening to you.
Okay, so fine. It's paclitaxel. It's paclitaxel in 90% of the cases.
Okay. There are patients who have COPD, although they are fit for surgery. So these are the patients where I'm a little nervous about using concurrent paclitaxel. And that is when I ask my medical oncologist if they would be comfortable using a single agent? And if they're using single agent, would they use carboplatin versus cisplatin?
So, ma'am, the point is here is the intent is curative. Again, we don't want to mess around with things. We do take a respiratory reference. And I think all in all your pre-op things, one major important thing which did not really come out on the fore was bronchoscopy. If you have any suspicion of tracheal invasion or bronchus invasion, please go ahead and do a bronchoscopy and a PFT. So we do a PFT and bronchoscopy prior to that. Every effort is made to give paclicarbo because it's a curative setting. I don't want to mess around, but yes, in an elderly 74, 75 elderly gentleman, I do go ahead with carboplatin also. I would be lying if I say I give only paclicarbo. We do, but every effort is made to give weekly paclicarbo. That's what I'll say.
So I think the point that Dr. Ulas is making is that the correct protocol is two drug. Only in a compromised setting, in less than 10% of the patients in your practice, probably you will get single agent chemotherapy, which can be either cisplatin or carboplatin. This patient did underwent PET scan and it showed partial response. And he was being planned for surgery. I want to come back to Dr. Rahul again. Dr. Rahul, do you ever go and see the radiation plans and do you discuss with your radiation oncologist how much dose have they given? What was the dose to the fundus of stomach, et cetera, before taking up these patients for surgery?
Yes, these things are discussed in detail because the tumor board meeting happens every week. So the patients who are undergoing therapy, the patients who have undergone therapy or patients who are to undergo therapy are always discussed. And the patient, when he or she is admitted, then also we do keep in touch with the radiation oncologist.
So I think the true multimodality treatment is not done only when you discuss the patient once. It has to be a continuum of the discussion. So the surgical oncologist and radiation oncologist have to be in line with each other. Could you tell us about your surgical approach, open, hybrid, minimally invasive, and what kind of lymphadenectomy generally do you do in these patients?
Here we regularly do a transthoracic minimally invasive approach. Recently we have started with robot-assisted thoracic dissections. And for the abdominal part, we usually open up and we do a laparotomy for that and then make a gastric tube and then pass it through the posterior mediastinum. And as far as the lymphadenectomy is concerned, it is usually a two-field lymphadenectomy and mediastinal and abdominal lymph nodes, posterior mediastinal and abdominal lymph nodes are dissected out. And at times when the lymph nodal burden is too high, then we may add recurrent laryngeal node also, but usually it is posterior mediastinal and abdominal lymph node dissection.
Okay. I want to ask you one more question. When you do a gastric pull-up, where do you place the stomach tube? Do you place it in the posterior mediastinum or are there any patients where you prefer to place it in the retrosternal location?
Oh, usually we place it in the posterior mediastinal location.
Hardly so would there be a subset of patients where you would be worried about anastomotic leakage, etc., and you would consider placing it in the retrosternal location?
Leak is not a concern by the while choosing the route of pulling the stomach up. So. I don't think I have not seen a case where we have used a retrosternal.
Fair enough. This patient did undergo surgery, which was transthoracic esophagectomy with gastric pull-up, and his histopathology report showed that there was some residual tumor, moderately differentiated squamous cell carcinoma, still infiltrating muscularis propria, margins were free, nodes were free, his TRG score was 2. So Dr. Anand and Dr. Ulas, any role of adjuvant chemotherapy or immunotherapy in the present scenario for this patient?
So no for chemotherapy, yes for immunotherapy.
Who would be the candidates? Would you do any testing or anyone who has residual disease should be considered?
I think I showed the data of CheckMate 577 in which there was no subset, no PD-L1, no age, nothing. So anybody who doesn't achieve a pathological CR did get nivolumab, and that was basically 22 versus 10 months DFS advantage. Unheard of. If cross was a game changer, this is a tournament changer. It's like a test match to one day cricket to T20 now.
So Ulas, you just now in your presentation you mentioned that one has to worry about finances also. So do you
think I never said that
the gain is so much, the gain is so much that you are ready to offer it to your next patient in the clinic?
I would want to discuss with them. I would want to discuss with them, ma'am. I would not like to take the decision all alone mine. Like we take a shared decision, the tumor board, I would like the patient's family to know that there's an option which exists. And then it is dependent on them, ma'am. I mean, I can't take the decision for them.
You've not yet started it in your practice. This is
no, not at all. Not right now, ma'am. Data just came two weeks back.
Okay. So just to give you a follow-up of this patient completed, we did not give him any adjuvant chemotherapy either. And he's 2 years post-treatment and his disease remains in remission. Dr. Rahul, you just now mentioned that you do two field lymph node dissection, which is also the routine practice across majority centers. We did our own analysis, the way Dr. Ulas was mentioning about the analysis being done in his institution. We found that 7% of our patients, they record in these nodes, which are called as, I think, recurrent laryngeal lymph nodes, the third field. 7% of these patients had a recurrent. None of these patients had a lymph node dissection in this area. What is your opinion? Should, you know, as a radiation oncologist, now what we do is we do image-based radiation therapy planning. For example, I will look at the gross tumor in the PET. I will look at the location of the lymph nodes, give it a margin, but I do not prophylactically include these stations. What is your take on this? Should it be prophylactically irradiated? Everyone should be getting third field, or who would be the candidate for that third field lymph node dissection? So or it would be too high?
There has been a very long debate over the years over three field versus two field. But as far as Indian patients are concerned and their body status is concerned, three-field lymphadenectomy is always deleterious for them in terms of complications in the post-operative period. So we have to we have to always balance our decisions based on the lymph nodal status, the position of the tumor, the size of the tumor. So this cannot be a blanket answer that we do three-field for everybody or we do two-field for everybody. As I said, we do include the recurrent laryngeal nodes at times when the nodal load is high or when there is the tumor is too proximal up in the mediastinum, in the upper mediastinum or in the middle mediastinum towards the upper side, then we do include recurrent laryngeal nerves. And there is enough, there has been meta-analysis and RCTs which have shown that, yes, the oncological outcomes are better if we do a three-field lymphadenectomy, but the post-operative outcomes do not allow us to actually go for three-field in every case. So it has to be balanced in every case. We cannot say that we will do three-field in all the patients. As you said that you do a planning before giving radiotherapy in these areas. You do not give radiotherapy in all these areas for every patient.
Because if we were to add radiation therapy prophylactically to these areas, the lung doses would certainly increase.
Yes.
The proximal part of the anastomosis, which is the cervical esophagus, will get higher dose. The anastomotic complications would also increase. So we even do not radiate these areas. But this is a common problem. Now, Dr. Rahul, that reminds me of another very common question. What is the upper limit of resectability? Meaning, as a postgraduate, I had learned 20 years back that you divide esophagus into two parts. Supracranial, infracranial. Infracranial goes to surgeon, supracranial goes to radiation oncologist. But I expect that the upper limit of resectability has now gone up. So how do we as a radiation oncologist look at the scan? Suppose you're not there in the clinic. How do we know that whether this patient is the candidate for surgery or not?
So it is not only about scans, which you have to look about. You will also have to rely on the endoscopic findings as well. So you have to correlate both of them. If you are able to get a 5 centimeter or 6 centimeter margin below the upper esophageal sphincter, then you may think that this patient can undergo surgery. But usually a tumor in the upper esophagus is non-resectable and he has to undergo a chemo radiation therapy as a therapy. Otherwise, medial mediastinal tumors or lower mediastinal tumors, they can always undergo surgery.
Is there any anatomical landmark for us? For example, arch of aorta or sternum or anything else? Or it is not a valid this thing?
As I said, it is you cannot rely on one thing. No? It has to be endoscopic versus this. So usually at the sternal notch, if we find a tumor above that, then usually it is not resectable.
Okay.
If you find a tumor below that, then it may think about and then again correlate both the things.
Okay. I think with this, I will quickly come to our second. Yes, Shefali, you want to say something?
Ma'am, can we wind up with the first? Because I think people are posting messages that if we can wind up or you wish to go. So then I would request our panelists, if they are not comfortable, they can leave so we can continue the discussion otherwise.
Okay.
Dr. Batra.
Ulas is texting you.
I have no issues. My wife has.
Sir, it's your wish, sir. Thank you so much for joining. So if you have commitment, you can leave. So otherwise, we'll continue, sir.
That's a lifelong commitment that I have, yaar.
Last day for this case.
So nice of you, sir. I'll be obliged. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ulas.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Vinita. I need to go. Need to have a go. Thank you. And thanks for the wonderful, wonderful, wonderful discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Ulas.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Shefali, Ulas has already left. You can tell me whenever you want me to stop. If you allow me, I will quickly.
No, ma'am. You can. If other panelists are comfortable, I think we can continue. They can tell us if they are comfortable.
Anand.
I need to go. Actually, it's already 9. I think.
Okay.
So, ma'am, I think we can wind up.
Yeah.
So, right.
So thank you so much, Shefali. Thank you, Dr. Nikhil. And thank you to all my panelists and everyone in the audience for this very interesting discussion. And over to you, organizers.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. And I appreciate that on the last moment, you did all your efforts to change the case. I understand that scenario. So so much thank you. And thank you all the panelists for taking up time and from their busy schedules. Dr. Nikhil, final word from you.
Thank you, Dr. Shefali, and it was an excellent discussion, Dr. Vinita. It was very fine points of this were brought out, and especially from the perspective of students, and this is what the program is meant for. And I would like to thank everyone, all the panelists and all the participants. Keep supporting us like this. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all of you. Thank you, attendees also. Thank you for joining.